Alright, so hi everybody, welcome back to our C++ programming lecture. Yeah, today we are going to talk about fun stuff, so template meta programming. We'll also talk about variadic template arguments, which can be quite useful from time to time, and also at the very end we are getting more serious now. We will be talking about smart pointers, which are very fundamental concept nowadays of modern C++. They have been introduced in C++ 11, and I'll give you some examples on why they are useful and how they can be used, and also how they can be implemented. So if you're bored at home, you could also implement your own version, your own smart pointers. All right, so, but now let's first of all start with template metaprogramming. So it's a bit of a fun topic because it's considered to be somewhat esoteric. So nowadays, using modern C++, it has rarely been used anymore. So you don't really need it anymore. Also, one does not really simply learn template metaprogramming as not since a pure functional programming language was found inside of the C++ compiler's template mechanism. So really templates are a built-in mechanism that's perfectly fine, but this template metaprogramming concept, this has been discovered only later on. So again, I already said it last time, if I recall correctly. So template metaprogramming has been found or has been discovered after introducing the template mechanism in C++. So, and template metaprogramming is also a Turing-complete language, which also means that every intuitive computable number can be computed. I mean, what does that mean? You can basically compute anything that is computable. So really, you can do everything in template metaprogramming. That also has some funny mathematical implementation, which is there cannot be a correct C++ compiler. I'm not sure about the practical implementations or the practical limitations and implications that this brings along, but you could probably look it up somewhere on the internet. And also, template metaprogramming is a bit esoteric, so nowadays you don't really have to use it anymore. Many software companies also do not allow it really, because if you use template metaprogramming, first of all, such code is really hard to write. It's even harder to read by someone else who did not develop that particular piece of code. So therefore, many software companies ban it completely, or at least to the extent that it is banned for all the parts where it is not essential. If you need to use it, really, you can also find within the Boost library a sublibrary which is called Boost HANA, which is your standard library for metaprogramming. So if you're interested in that sort of stuff, you can check out this Boost sublibrary here. But I mean, since C++ 11 and onwards, so you can just use const expression to have const expression functions which are evaluated at compile time, rather than using the TMP template metaprogramming mechanism. We see why that is on the next few slides. So I have some kind of fun example where you can see how mad you can go with that TMP mechanism, really. Before we start about TMP, we need to discuss one more thing before we can make that all work. And the thing really is, so the basic concept why template metaprogramming works at all is that template metaprogramming uses types in order to express computations. So that's very important to notice. And in order to get some values into types, we can do the following, as shown here in this example. So what you could do is you could have a struct or also a class, doesn't really matter, and you could give it a static variable. So if you define a struct A, for instance, here you give it a static const int value data member, and you initialize that integer to 100. And now the question that you may ask is, yeah, what does static mean in that context? So what does it mean to have a static member variable? And the meaning is essentially that this static member variable, data member, is statically shared across all instances, that is all variables, of type A, of that particular type you define that static variable or data member in. So a static data member is shared across all instances of this type here. What does it mean? So that means, and also how could you access it? An example is shown here in the main function. So you could have two variables, A and B, both of type A. And you can, by using both variables, A and B, you could access the data member value by just using the dot operator dot value, and then you could read out its value of 100, for instance. However, as static variables, static data members are also shared across all instances, you don't even need a particular instance of that type. So you could also just use the type's name, A, colon, colon, value, to access its value. So static data members are kind of baked into the type. So they are part of the type itself and not part of a concrete instance. That may be a good way of thinking about it. So again, I already said that they belong to the type itself, so they are really part of the type. And that's great news for template metaprogramming because types can now store values by using static variables, static data members. And with values, of course, we can perform computations. That's the clue here. So what we can now do is using C++'s ordinary template mechanism, we can now describe and perform computations with types. And the reason why that works is we can have values stored within types by using static data members. That's the clue. And templates themselves are just processing types. So congrats, you just discovered template metaprogramming. All right, and template metaprogramming itself is, yeah, a functional language. So the control flow is directed by recursion. So you don't have ordinary control flow in terms of recursion, but you don't really have sequential code that is executed one statement after the other. So it's a bit different. So a functional language, yeah. You compute using recursion, exactly, and here we can have an example which computes the power function. So one number to the power of a different number and then gives us the power function here. And the final usage will look like the code on the right hand side. So we will be using types. So power will be a type. We have to define type power. Then just give me a second. All right, so where have we stopped? Power, yes. So for template metaprogramming, we of course need a type. Here in this case, it will be the power type. And also, of course, because it's called template metaprogramming, we are going to make use of template parameters, which you can find here in Angular brackets. So, and this expression basically describes the function 2 to the power of 10, which is some value, of course. And now let's see, how does it work? How can we make it work? So Again, we are using recursion because it's a pure functional language, so we can only use functions, but that's good enough, so we can express everything in recursion. So that means we first of all describe the base case, and for that we have a struct power which receives one template parameter, one integer b for the base, would be this 2 here, and in case the second template parameter is a 0, we define a static data member, a static const integer value as a 1. So we define such a data member and set it to 1, initialize it to 1. And this is basically the base case here, where the second parameter is 0. And now we also have to define the general case. And the general case, of course, is also a type power. So we use struct here, struct power. We give it two template parameters, one integer and one unsigned. So the integer is b for base, and the unsigned is an exponent. And so what's the value here? Now here is the place where we apply recursion. So we define a static const int data member value, so in essence it's an integer, and we define it to be b times, and then we instantiate the template power again, so it's power of b and e minus 1, colon colon value. So what happens now is, because, I mean, templates are instantiated statically at compile time, whenever you're using a template which does not yet exist, the compiler will generate one. So templates are, in fact, I already told you last time, so templates are code generators. And if a template does not yet exist, the compiler will generate one and will instantiate templates as needed. So while you are using this expression here, you instantiate the power type with the template parameters 2 and 10, and then access the data member value. So now the compiler will go ahead and will instantiate a power type with the template parameters 2 and 10. And in order to be able to access its value, which we do here, the compiler now needs to evaluate this expression on the right-hand side of the assignment operator here. And on the right-hand side, we have a different template. We have a template power b and e minus 1, so 2 and 9. But we haven't seen this template yet, so the compiler has to generate this and instantiate this template again in order to access its value, and so the recursion starts all over again. And the recursion continues and continues and continues, until you reach the special case where the second parameter of the second template parameter of the power type is 0. And at this point, you just define the data member value to be 1, and then the recursion stops, and then the compiler is able to compute the final value. So that's the basic idea behind template metaprogramming. So usually you have some static const data members, and then you use those to store a value, and you use the types as kind of functions, and then you misuse the template mechanism. That's the basic idea. Okay, so that's the code again we had on the last slide. And in programming using templates, types are used as functions, and they can get types, constant values, or references to functions as input parameters. And here we see they all get instantiated with a constant value, so int b and unsigned e. And they can store again another type using typedef. They can also store a constant by using the enum keyword or static const, and here the static const, which I also presented in this small example here, is usually the preferred way. And the control flow you will direct using recursion. So in our example, templates get instantiated until the base case is reached, and then the whole expression is spelled out, so to say, and is computed at the very end. And so p will eventually contain the value of 2 to the power of 10, which is exactly what we wish to express. However, I mean, first of all, on the left-hand side, the TMP code looks a bit messy, and you're not really used to see such kind of codes in C++, I guess, so it feels rather unnatural. And so, since C++11, you can do better than that. So you could also, for instance, just define an ordinary function for that, which takes two integers. So one signed integer base and one unsigned integer for the exponent. And then you can also just define a recursion similar to the left-hand side here using TMP, but here on the right-hand side you are using ordinary C++, so to say. And by making it a const expr function, so a const expression function, this function here can also be evaluated at compile time. So it's pretty much the same thing. And then a usage of that const expression power function would be just call it power with the parameters 2 and 10. And so this function here can be evaluated at compile time statically. So it has the same performance in terms that you do not pay any runtime cost. And I personally think that the right-hand side looks much more readable, looks much nicer because, again, it's ordinary C++ code to which you're used. So what you can also do is you can even realize data structure. So some guys on the internet wrote some blog posts showed how they realized like simple linked lists or simple lists using TMP. So you can do all sorts of crazy stuff. But really, this is not much of use. It's kind of for some intellectual games, really. But in reality, you do not have to use TMP a lot. For most of the things, you can use const expression functions. So it doesn't buy you much, rather than just being fun to you, if you maybe mentally a bit unstable, and that might be fun to you. So the sane way probably would be to use templates, like for instance for the triple type, as you did in the current exercises. C++ tuple type is implemented using template metaprogramming, so there are some instances where you really need it. For instance, again, a set here in the for the C++ tuple type, which is defined in the STL. Lists again are also possible, but yeah, I mean it's insanity at some point. So, and here I will show you, this example is taken from the internet, so I haven't thought of it myself. I just going to present you what kind of insanity you can do with TMP. So let's give ourselves a simple task. Let's try to compute Euler's number at compile time using template metaprogramming. So I know there are many formulas in order to compute Euler's number E, but for this task here we are using this formula. So it's an it's basically an infinite sum from 0 to infinity. And we sum up all the values 1 over k faculty. And this gives you a rough approximation. I mean, this sum is exactly E, but as you probably know, we cannot perform infinite computations. Otherwise, our program wouldn't terminate. So we have to set an upper bound, and if we set an upper bound, we get an arbitrary precise approximation of the Euler's number E. So let's use template metaprogramming. I need a few slides because the code gets quite verbose. We need a few things here using template metaprogramming. We need a fraction, so somehow we need to represent fractions. We have numerator and denominator, so we can just define a type for that, frac. We give it two template parameters of type integer. Because again, you can only use integer arguments for templates, so doubles are not allowed or any other floating point numbers. So we have n and d, and we store them in the constant static integer data members num and den. Then let's create a different kind of function in TMP. And if we wish to create a function in TMP, we have to use a type for that, because types are used as functions in TMP. So in order to perform a multiplication, we can have a struct mult, and we have an int x and a type name f. And the thing is here, the idea is that the second template parameter will get a fraction, and the first parameter, the integer x, is basically just the scale. And then the result of the multiplication we store with a type def, where we say, hey, let's define a type alias, which we call value here, which is a fraction where you take f's numerator and multiply it by x, and you take f's denominator and multiply it by x. And you assume that hopefully the user will, as a second template parameter, the user of that mechanism will provide a fraction. In order to make things work, we also need something which computes the greatest common divisor for us. So x and y, you give us two template parameters, and the greatest common divisor is y and x modulo y, and then you access the value of whatever that is. And then you also need recursion for the base case, where the second parameter is zero. And you already start that this is going to be complicated, and this is going to be a nightmare. And I now just go quickly through all this kind of stuff here. You can now also have some kind of function which simplifies fraction. So we give it a fraction as an input, and we use GCD to simplify that thing. we can also have a thing which takes two fractions and gives us the same base of those fractions. Then we can also have a kind of a TMP function, therefore we use a type which sums up to fractions x and y, and we do all kinds of magic here, as you can see. But we need a bit more. We also need a factorial function, which we define here. Here we have a base case for that factorial function. And then finally, we can compute E, Euler's number. And we also have to compute Euler's number using recursion. So this is would be the general case. If you wish to take the sum till the nth term of the sum. And we also need a default case if we to provide a general case for our recursion here, and then recursion stops. So where we ask for the zeroth part of the sum would be that one here. And at the very end, we can use all that trickery here really to compute Euler's number up till the 12th term. We access its value. So at this point, the compiler's template mechanism will unroll all the templates here required in order to access the value, which we also type def in another type x here to make it easier to use. And then at the very end, we just have to perform the division here. because that is, we didn't do that in templates here. So, and at the very end, we have to do the final division, because this one will give us a floating point number, and floating point numbers cannot be handled in TMP. So the last division at the very end we have to do at runtime, but I think that's negligible. And so here we can print the final value. So yeah, it's really madness. In practice, you wouldn't use it, I guess. Because in practice, what you would use, and here we are using the same formula, rather than using TMP, you would use const expression functions. So you can also, and you can do the same kind of functional style of programming. So you can compute Euler's number up till the end, nth term here, and you also use a factorial function, which you can define here also as a const expression function. And then you can compute the const expression double e by calling the function Euler with the input 12, and it will also perform the computation statically. In addition, since C++ 14, you can also use, you not only can use recursion, but you can also use imperative programming here. For instance, you can use a for loop, which would not be possible in TMP. And let's see if the compiler could really evaluate that call to the Euler function at compile time. Let's see if it worked. So what we can do, for instance, is we can ask Clang++. I know Clang and the Clang++ compiler best, and this is why I sometimes show you this kind of trickery here. So we can ask the compiler to give us the compiler's intermediate representation by using the flags dash emit dash llvm and dash uppercase s. And then we can obtain the human readable compiler's intermediate representation, which would look like follows. And if you look carefully, this number here, this floating point number, which is presented in hexadecimal, is of type double, and this is exactly this e here. And if you go on the internet and convert this hexadecimal number into the decimal system, you will find that this is pretty much Euler's number, in an approximated form, of course. So it worked, so you don't have to use TMP. So if we are discussing about the pros and cons, so pros, sure, TMP stuff gets evaluated at compile time. And so why should you postpone something which can be done at compile time to runtime? Because then it might be even more expensive. If you can do it statically at compile time, you only have to do it once, and then you can run your program multiple times, and it already has computed the value. So you don't need to waste any runtime. Also, higher abstraction is possible. Again, there are some scenarios where you still need TMP, but in many cases, you can just replace it with const expression functions. On the negative aspect side here, we really have as a con, the compile time gets longer. Sure, if the compiler compiles the code, then it first of all has to enroll all your templates. It has to do all the template instantiations that are required, and then it needs to compile the resulting code, basically. So they are hard to read and even harder to write, or the other way around, doesn't really matter. So both is incredibly hard if you do some if you try to solve some tasks using TMP, which are more complicated. Also, the functional style does not really match C++, because C++ is mostly used as a kind of imperative programming language, using statements. So one statement follows the other, and then you direct control flow by using branching and and loops and that sort of thing. It's also, TMP is not supported by development tools, so good luck on your own. The error messages usually make no sense at all, so, or are at least really, really hard to read. So that's also a negative aspect, and probably also heavily overused again nowadays. You don't need it really. And no, you don't have type information. I won't go into details on this one, but on the last slide, probably could also you could already observe it for the function, kind of function thingy, which was called simplify. We put in a type name f, and this f better is of type frac, so a fraction, but we can't really enforce it, so we can't use that kind of type information here. So for TMP, yeah, we can't use type information, which makes it much more error prone than ordinary programming. So again, I already said it multiple times, so you should know it by now. Unless you have good reason to do otherwise, use const expression functions. All right, that would be already it on TMP, I guess. If you need to look something up, yeah, just go on the internet and look how you do stuff with TMP if you ever need to do that. You can also use templates for variadic template arguments. So you can have basically variadic template arguments. How does that work? I'll give you an example, and also we had this example in the current exercise sheet. So what you can have when you use templates, you can not only have one template parameter t, you can also have a so-called an argument pack of template parameters. So if you use class or type name, again, class and type name here as template parameters can be used interchangeable. So, and if you put three dots behind the type name or class, then you make it an argument pack. That means, yeah, you have arbitrary many other template arguments that follow. And what you can implement, for instance, using that variadic template arguments is, yeah, for instance, you can implement an add function, which returns the template type T, returns the type T. As inputs, it gets some type T, some argument of type T, lowercase t. And as other arguments, it gets an argument pack, which can be anything really. And what you can do here within this add function, you can now have a t plus, and then again, you call yourself recursively. Call the add function again with the remaining arguments of the argument pack. And if you use that name args dot dot dot, you're basically expanding the argument pack. This is a syntax for expanding the arguments, which is just call the add function with all the remaining template arguments that you might find. And then, of course, we also need a base case because, this thing here again is TMP uses recursion. So we can also have a base case of the function add where we only really receive one template type T. And if we need to add a single thing, we are pretty much already done and we can immediately return T. So this would be our base case here. And then how could we use it? We could, for instance, use the add function in the following sense. We can give it 10 integer arguments, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, if we have all integers, you could use the variadic template arguments. And what the compiler will do, the compiler will generate add functions on the fly by using this template trickery here. It will generate code for add functions. One add function which receives 10 arguments. And again, this gets reduced by the second template here to a call to the add function with 9 integers. Because here we used one here and then we have some remaining input arguments. So the compiler will also generate an add function that receives 9 integers. Then again, we go recursively,
call add again here. So it will generate an additional add function with 8 integer arguments and so on until we reach the base case. And then the compiler generated plenty of add functions, which can then finally be evaluated, and we are left with the final sum here at compile time. Or at compile time, at least, those add functions are generated. They might be also called then at runtime. However, if you use a function which can receive arbitrary many inputs of the same type, rather than using that kind of trickery here, you should probably use initializer list instead. So compiler can deduce templates parameters here in this case. Yeah, so we don't have to put in any arguments. Okay, so if you have parameters all of the same type, you can use that thing there I just showed you, or you should probably try to prefer initializer list, so std initializer list. But the thing I showed you on the last slide can be useful if you need if you ever need to implement a function that can print everything. So if you need to define a function that prints, that needs to print, for instance, arbitrary many arguments of arbitrary types, then you need that kind of stuff. So what you could do is, for instance, you could define yourself a function, print everything, you give it 2 template parameters, or you give it one template parameter and one argument pack, and then you print the T, the first thing, and then you call yourself again and you expand the argument pack of the remaining template arguments. And again, we are using recursion here, so that also means that we need a base case. In the base case, we just expect one template argument and we print it, and then we are done. And you could use it as follows. So you could call your print everything function with a C style string, so a char star, an integer, a double, and a std string. And it would still work, so it would still print everything that implements here the output stream operator, which all of those do, in fact. So if you ever need that, you might wish to use that mechanism here. That would be probably it about TMP. We do not need more for this course. If you're interested in that kind of stuff, yeah, go on the internet and look it up yourself. Again, oftentimes you don't really need it. Let's get maybe more serious now. Let's talk about smart pointers, which in turn, opposed to the other stuff before, are really quite useful and quite important. So please just once more recall raw pointers. So for raw pointers, raw pointers, you can store addresses. For instance, you can have an int i, 42, and then you can have a pointer to an integer and let that pointer to an integer point to the integer variable I. And so iptr stores i's address. So that's just a fun example, but for many scenarios, pointers are absolutely necessary. For instance, for dynamic memory allocation. So if you ask your operating system, yeah, please allocate me an integer array of 12 integers, again, the system can only provide you with a pointer, giving you the address to the heap where it allocated that block of 12 integers for you. And then you can access the integer array using the dynamic array pointer here. You can do stuff with that memory, and eventually, if you no longer need that memory, you can use the corresponding array delete to delete the dynamically allocated memory. Same holds for allocating single objects. So you can also allocate an individual integer by calling operator new with an int. Default constructor, so the int will be zero initialized. Will it? No, probably not. So probably only initialize it here. Probably only allocate it here. And then operator new gives you the address where that integer is or resides on the heap. You can do stuff with it, and at the very end, you can delete that heap allocated integer by using delete, and you give the operator delete the corresponding address. So what was the problem here? The major problem was that you will probably at some point forget to use delete. And also you will probably forget to use the corresponding delete. Because if you allocate with array new and if you just use ordinary delete, then it's all also already undefined behavior. That's rubbish. So you don't, you are not even allowed to mix up those new and delete operators. Finding memory leaks can be quite on the expensive side in terms of time, and usually then also money. So finding memory leaks can cost days, weeks, or maybe even more than that. And for that purpose, smart pointers have really been invented. So you can think of smart pointers as safe wrappers for raw pointers. So maybe before we talk about smart pointers, let's quickly talk about ownership problematic, because that's really the underlying problem to which it all boils down to. So if you have, for instance, a function matrix multiply, which takes two matrices, pointer to matrices as input, so A and B, for instance, and then as a result, it returns the resulting matrix multiplication result, it returns as a pointer to a matrix as well. So the matrix multiplication implementation here allocates a new matrix C on the heap, and it returns a pointer at the very end. So it performs the computation of the matrix multiplication and then return a pointer to that matrix. The problem here is now, okay, so matrix multiply allocates that matrix on the heap. But the question is, who frees that memory again? So who is responsible for that piece of memory to which the matrix multiply function returns the pointer to? That's the main problem. What's for sure is that it has to be deleted at some point. Otherwise you leak memory. And the problem in general is who is responsible for a piece of memory? Who owns the resource? If I talk about resource, I mostly mean memory, but a resource could also be something else, could also be file handle or something else. Yeah, so who allocates memory and who frees it after usage? That's the question here. And there are pretty much three usage patterns that you can have. You can have the usage pattern caller allocates and caller frees. That would be that example, where the matrix multiplication function takes three pointers to matrices, and the memory management has to be done by the caller of that function. You just give it the pointer to the correct memory. There's also the scenario where you have callee allocates, caller frees, which would be that function here as an example. So a caller of that function, someone at some point would call that function, and this function, the callee, will allocate. And it will give you the pointer to the allocated heap memory. And then you, as the caller, are responsible to free it at the right point in time of your program. And then you can also have the mechanism callee allocates and callee frees. An example are std string, std vector. Those completely take care of the memory management for you. You don't really need to be concerned with that as a user. So this is also a possibility. And whatever you use, you have to decide on one of those usage patterns, so to say. So that was a quick intro to ownership problematic. And now smart pointers really help with that ownership problematic. Because the smart pointers really know who owns the resource. So the smart pointers also do the cleanup, which most of the time means they call delete themselves. So smart pointers know who owns what resource, and smart pointers also do the cleanup for you. So, which pretty much means you cannot forget to clean up a resource. What they essentially are doing is they automatically call the destructor if the managed resource has no owner anymore. Then it's safe to delete the resource, and the smart pointer will do that fully automatically for you. In other terms, if something has no user anymore, it can be safely deleted. How does it work? The smart pointers calls delete for object pointing to when their own destructor is called. So when a smart pointer's destructor is called, they just call delete on the managed resource pointer that they have as a data member. And smart pointers again know about ownership. This is no real garbage collector, so it's more or less just reference counting, aka the Poorman's garbage collector. But this is really not a garbage collector as you know it in Java, as you know it from other languages, for instance for Java, from Java. but here you only pay for what you're using, so you only pay for the counter variables and incrementing, decrementing reference counters. So, pretty neat, pretty fast. And by the way, if you think, yeah, garbage collection is the greatest thing whatsoever, I mean, in Java, you just allocate everything with new, and then the virtual machine that your Java program runs on will take care of collecting all that memory that has no users anymore itself. But it's also possible to leak resources in Java, even though it has actually a garbage collector, but you can still leak in Java. you have three types of smart pointers in C++. We will go through all of them. One of them is not very important. I only give you a small example, and if you ever need it, you can look it up yourself. So the most important ones are, first of all, std unique pointer. That can be used whenever you have a unique ownership. So that basically means, in other words, you have one user at a time. You can also have a std shared pointer for shared ownership, which means that you have one or more users at a time for a given object or resource. And then you have a weak pointer. And this is the smart pointer I just told is not that relevant, really. This is for non-owned things. And a weak pointer does not own, but is allowed to use the underlying object. Again, this might be also the most complicated thing to understand, but we will have a small example on that one as well. Again, it's not commonly used in practice. But the other two are tremendously useful, so unique and shared pointer. And the smart pointers are implemented in the STL. You can include the header file memory, and then you can use those smart pointers. So let's first of all discuss the unique pointer, maybe. So unique pointer behaves like an ordinary pointer, which is a good thing, first of all. So let's have a small example. So let's have some piece of data. Let's define a data type called data. Let's give it some data members, x and y. And let's maybe also, for shorthand, give it a small constructor, which takes two double arguments, x and y, and it uses the double arguments to initialize its own data members, x and y. And other than initializing its data members, it shouldn't do anything. What we can now do is, we can allocate an object of type data on the heap. So using operator new, we say, yeah, please, I would like to have a new data. Here we are using the constructor, give it some double values. And this expression here, this new expression will allocate an object of type data on the heap, and it will initialize member variables x and y with those values. And of course, the operator new returns a pointer to that piece of memory on the heap. And that pointer we use to initialize this variable data pointer, which is of type unique pointer. Unique pointer, you need to give the type that it should manage. So here we wish to have a unique pointer manage a thing of type data. So we give unique pointer as a template parameter the type it should manage, which is data again. And here this data pointer is the variable of type unique pointer to data. And this data pointer we initialize with that new expression here. So it eventually contains the address to the piece of heap memory we just allocated. And yeah, we can compile this piece of code here and run it, and we will have no leaks. So it will do the cleanup itself. So although we don't have any delete in our program, at least not currently visible in our user code, it will work perfectly fine. Ah, again, here a small figure. So we have this piece of memory on the heap. And then data pointer is just a handle to that piece of heap memory, which can be pretty much used as an ordinary pointer to access those heap memory. Again, we also do not explicitly use delete. Did it work? We don't know. Maybe let's call Valgrind. If we call Valgrind, it will tell us one allocation took place and one free has been performed. So obviously we don't leak, which is great news. So apparently this system here worked. You can also use a factory function for initializing a unique pointer. So rather than using the new keyword and the operator new, you can also use the factory function make unique. So make unique creates a shared pointer to a thing of type data that you give it here as a template parameter. And then you provide it with some arguments which are forwarded to the constructor of data. So you can also create a unique pointer by using the factory function make unique. And make unique under the hood allocates a thing, an object of type data on the heap, and initializes it with the those arguments here. And then we are left with a data pointer which stores the pointer to the heap where our data is located. Make unique exists since C++ 14. It has kind of forgotten. I should rather say it has not been forgotten. It has been introduced in C++ 14 later on to make things, to give things a unified look and feel. So in C++ 11, just use new, as we did on the last slide, to create stuff on the heap and then let it be handled by a unique pointer. So how to model a unique pointer? What would you need to do in order to implement your own unique pointer type? I mean, you can go ahead and directly implement your own unique pointer, which does kind of reference counting here, which behaves exactly like unique pointer. You can do it yourself. So how would you do it? You would probably make your unique pointer type a class providing a pointer to the resource. So probably you would have some pointer of template parameter t to the underlying resource it should manage. How would you then ensure, if you wish to implement your own unique pointer, how would you ensure that data pointer is only used by one user at a time? You would disallow copying the smart pointer, which you can easily do by just saying, just delete the copy constructor. So you can also use equals delete to disable the copy constructor. You can also then disable the copy assignment operator. And this disallows your a variable of your type from being copied. And if you try to copy anyway, the compiler will throw an error at you saying that this will not work, this is not allowed. So now we can only have one data pointer. Attempts of copying that thing result in a compiler error. So the underlying resource can only have one owner, so to say, and copying is not allowed. So how is data pointer able to delete its resource? Yeah, I mean, you could just use its destructor to delete the underlying resource. So you could implement the destructor like that here. So now the resource is cleaned up for us, which is great, which is exactly what we wanted. But now also we have an additional question. So how to use it elsewhere if copying is disallowed? Yeah, I mean, then we could probably use move, right? So use the move constructor to move things around rather than copying it. Exactly. So how about dereferencing? I just told you that you can use smart pointers, or that smart pointers behave pretty much like ordinary raw pointers. So how can you get that? You can in C++. You can also you can overload the dereference operator, which is this one here, and you can also allow you can also overload the error operator, which is dereference and access. A member of the managed resource. So you can overload these operators here on your smart pointer type, and then it will behave pretty much like an ordinary raw pointer type, raw pointer. So here, another example. So we can have our data type, we still have our data type data. We have a set zero function, which accepts a unique pointer to data D. It sets the members x and y to zero. That's what the name also suggests. And then it returns the unique pointer here, d, as a return value. in the main function, we allocate some data object on the heap, initialize it, and use the unique pointer data ptr, which now owns that resource here. We can then call the set zero function and then print both of its value x and y, so both of its data members, and then return. And here we're just checking if set zero worked. The problem now is that this piece of code does not work anymore, because what happens if we call set zero here and we pass data pointer as a parameter? We pass unique pointer by value, which is not allowed, because a unique pointer is not allowed to be copied. Copy constructor and copy assignment operators are deleted. So what do we do? So yeah, that's what I just said. If you try to copy a unique pointer, a variable of type unique pointer, you get you would have more than one user, which is not allowed. So he would have two owners, main and set zero. That's not allowed. And what we do instead of copying it, we would move the data instead of copying it. So we would move a data PTR to set zero into the set zero function, and then the set zero function is responsible for that. So we gave ownership from the main function to the set zero function. Then set zero is responsible for that. And if set zero returns the D to the main again, then main is all of a sudden again responsible for that resource, which is handled by the unique pointer data PTR. So yeah, we have to use move, and then that'll work. of course, after you moved stuff around, please don't use the variables you moved from after you moved from them, because that's undefined behavior. That will probably lead to a segmentation fault if you're lucky. The second move here is hidden. So whenever you return stuff from a function as a value, pretty much fully automatically the move constructor will be called. So the second move really from set 0 back to main is hidden, so to say. But it is added automatically by the compiler. You don't need to be concerned with that, because the compiler will complain if you forget a move, and then you can add it wherever necessary. So don't worry, the compiler will tell you if you forgot a move when using unique pointers. So next shared pointer. Shared pointers allow for multiple users. Here's an example again, same data structure, or data type, data, two doubles as members. And here we just replace shared pointer by unique pointer. And here we again allocate an object of type data on the heap, initialize it with those values here using the constructor. And the resulting pointer is stored in a shared pointer variable data, PTR. And again, shared pointer is also templated with the type of the object it should manage. We can now just call the set0 function again. It accepts the shared pointer, it does some stuff to the underlying data of the managed resource, and then it returns the shared pointer to the data object. Then we can print the values x and y, and they will be 0. And this works here. And the idea of shared pointer is that it will keep track of the number of its owners by using an internal counter. So the shared pointer obviously also is a data type, exactly as unique pointer is also a data type, of course. And the shared pointer data type has some reference counter in it. And it can increase the reference counter as it has more and more users. And as the number of users decrease, the counter gets decremented. And of course, if the reference counter, if the user counter is 0, then it can be safely deleted as it has no users anymore. That's the basic idea. And the set0 function can now here be used without move, because a shared pointer, opposed to a unique pointer, can be copied. So shared pointers can be copied around, as we allow for more than one user. Does it still clean up? So if you type that into a file, and if we compile that file, and if we run it using Valgrind, we can see that we have two allocations and two frees. Okay. Here we can also improve on our example. Here we can use the factory function similarly to our unique pointer, which was make unique. Here we can also use make shared. We can make shared accepts a template of the type that it should allocate. So this is actually an error, because that must be an uppercase D, because the type name is uppercase D data. So make shared, please allocate object of type data on the heap and initialize it with those values, and then store the result in data PTR, which is now our shared pointer managing that resource. So this line here is important. This make shared makes a difference, because it reduces the number of allocations. As you observed on the last slide, we had in fact two allocations, and you might wonder, why do we have two allocations? We only used one new. That's correct, but shared pointer itself, the shared pointer type itself, also needs to allocate some memory on the heap, because the shared pointer type manages the reference counter on the heap. So it is stored on the heap, which also means the shared pointer itself has to allocate some data on the heap, which leads to two overall allocations and then of course two deletes or two frees, so to say. However, when you use the factory function make shared here, this makes a huge difference because the factory function here allocates the data type, the type that you wish to allocate, as well as the data to manage all the references in one block of memory, in one contiguous block of memory, which leads to increased performance. So first of all, it only takes one allocation because it allocates it all in one chunk of memory. And in addition, you don't have, you have not fragmented your memory because again, it only sits in one block of memory. It can be accessed a lot faster. So this one does only one allocation and it stores data and reference counter in one block of memory, which is more efficient. I just told you that. And if you compile the problem here, run it and use Valgrind to analyze it, you will also see that it only really uses one allocation and one deallocation. So maybe also let's discuss what would you need to do if you wish to implement a shared pointer yourself to give you a better idea on how it actually works under the hood, similarly to the unique pointer type. So how would you model a shared pointer? It's pretty easy as well, once you've got the basic idea. So shared pointer you will probably model as a class, which has as a data member a pointer to the underlying resource. That sounds pretty reasonable. How to store the number of users or references? We also have to solve that problem. Just store the number of users and references in a counter variable. So you have some counter variable in your shared pointer type, which counts the number of users or references. How to copy? again, you are allowed to have multiple users of a shared pointer, or basically of the underlying object. So you are, of course, allowing copying. So copying is perfectly fine when using shared pointers. You just perform a flat copy of the handle. What you don't do is you don't copy the managed resource. And in your copy constructor, you increment the reference counter. Because whenever you copy a thing, yeah, you have a new user of that thing. So you increment the counter in the copy constructor. When to delete the resource? When the internal reference counter is zero, so for every destructor of that shared pointer type, whenever a destructor is called, the internal reference counter is decremented. And once it hit zero, then it has no users anymore. And then you can call delete safely and deallocate your resource that you're managing. So that would pretty much do the following. So here in this first line, you would have something on the heap. Make shared would allocate an object of type data on the heap, initialize it with those values. And also, because you're calling make shared, it will put the reference counter also on the heap in the same block of memory. And then the user, then a handle, a data PTR, is just a pointer to that block of heap memory here. And this data pointer just resides on the stack as a local variable. All right. So now we are calling the set zero function. And that means that this handle here, this data PTR, is copied because set zero accepts a shared pointer by value. The shared pointer is copied into that function. And now you have a second user D within the set zero, which also points to the same block of memory on the heap. Set zero eventually also returns something and stores it in zero. So you also have a third user variable 0, which also points to the same piece of memory. And then once those users go out of scope, their destructor is being called, and so they decrement the reference counter. And once all the handles here are basically destroyed, the destructor is called, the ref counter will hit 0 again, and the destructor for that piece of heap memory will be called for you. So you don't leak memory, which is exactly what we wish to achieve here. All right, one example on weak pointer. Weak pointer can hold a reference, but is not an owner. What does it mean? Maybe let's have some simple example for that. So let's have a global variable of type weak pointer to integer. So this is the weak pointer to an integer. We just call WP, or for WP for weak pointer, of course. We have, maybe let's define a function f, which tries to read from the weak pointer. I will explain what that means in a second. So let's try to read from the weak pointer. If that succeeds, we just print the underlying integer, the managed resource in this case. If we can't read from the weak pointer, then the weak pointer is expired and we have to do something else. And then we can, for instance, in main, we can introduce the scope where we create a shared pointer to an integer, initialize that with 42. Then we can let the weak pointer point to the shared pointer. We can now call f and try to read from the weak pointer. And then we can close the scope and call f again. So now maybe let's go into more details what happens here. So again, we call, we allocate an integer on the heap, initialize it to 42, and let it be managed by the shared pointer sp. I told you previously that a weak pointer is not an owner, but it can refer to a smart pointer. So by basically storing the shared pointer in that weak pointer, yeah, you can, using that weak pointer, you can still look at this resource, but it doesn't own, so to say. And what does it mean? Now the thing here, why I introduced the scope here. So if we call f within this first scope here, which we just introduced, if we call f, then we try to read the resource that the weak pointer refers to. And we can do that by using the member function lock. And the member function lock returns a shared pointer, and we can now look at the underlying resource and modify it or do whatever we wish to do with it. In this case, we just print out the underlying integer to the command line. All right, so far so good. But it could also be, and in the first call to f, this works. We can lock it because the shared pointer still exists, and the weak pointer still refers to the shared pointer, which manages the underlying object, and everything is perfectly fine. So we will enter this first case here, the first branch. Okay, and then we can here print the underlying integer. Then we close that scope, which means that the shared pointer goes out of scope, which means the resource is deleted. And also the shared pointer is deleted, and destructor is called, and all that good stuff. And now the weak pointer is basically not valid anymore because the underlying resource has been already removed, so to say. Which is why the second call to f within another scope will go into the second branch here, because you cannot lock the weak pointer anymore. So this function call to the member function lock will return the null pointer whenever weak pointer points to something which has been removed already, and therefore you don't get the lock, and you will go into that branch printing that the weak pointer is expired. So weak pointer are sometimes useful. So weak pointer is to model things or to model users of a resource which are just looking at a thing, which just need to look at a thing, but which don't own themselves. So for an observer, so to say, but not an owner. So you really rarely you need to use it anymore. So weak pointer must be copied into a SharePoint in order to be used. That's also what we did here in this line where we called the member function log. But in general, that mechanism works here. So we have one allocation and one free. And in the second line here, it prints that one. Except I did a spelling mistake at some point, I guess. But other than that, it'll work perfectly fine. So a note on smart pointers. So smart pointers massively reduce the probability of introducing memory leaks. So please try to use smart pointers whenever possible or whenever sensible. So if you need to manage resources, yeah, prefer using smart pointers rather than raw pointers. If it makes sense and you know that you only have one owner at a time, it probably makes sense to also express that semantically and to prefer unique pointer rather than shared pointer. Other than that, smart pointers behave like raw pointers, so the operators are overloaded, so you can really use the arrow operator, you can dereference them using the asterisk operator. And shared pointer, of course, need a tiny little bit more memory because they have to store the reference counter as well. That's hopefully understandable. But really, you can, I mean, on modern machines, we usually have enough memory. So really only fall back to raw pointers if you really cannot afford a few bytes more per variable when using the shared pointer. If your platform cannot or does not provide an STL implementation, also then you probably don't have another choice than using raw pointers. Of course, you could also craft your own smart pointer implementations, but yeah, you have to decide on the concrete use case. Also, if you implement an algorithm, of course, then it's perfectly fine to just have a raw pointer. But again, whenever you manage resources or so, you probably wish to use smart pointers instead. And there might also be some other good reasons why not to use smart pointers. And then in those cases, of course, you are still allowed to use raw pointers. I mean, you as a developer, you as a programmer, you are anyway allowed to do whatever you wish to do. But yeah, for your own good, please try to use those sane methods and mechanisms to reduce the number of errors that you can do. That's the main idea, I guess. So after we have now discussed on smart pointers, maybe one more note on dynamic memory allocation. So if you have to dynamically allocate objects, then pretty much try to use smart pointers. If you have to dynamically allocate an array of objects, just use std vector, because std vector under the hood allocates an array of objects on the heap. So use vector for arrays, use smart pointers for individual objects. But also don't think there are no exceptions. So raw pointers are still needed, of course, when implementing algorithms. If you are only a user and not an owner of a resource, you usually nowadays also just use the raw pointer rather than the weak pointer. So you would probably use a raw pointer for just looking at a thing. And I guess there are plenty of other reasons and use cases. So what's the current status now? Let's discuss about the current status. So you know very much about modern C++ at this point in time already, probably also more than your older professors, probably like this guy here. So I know C++. We will discuss in the next few lectures about object-oriented programming, but I mean the most important mechanisms you know at this point already know and already have learned about. So again, what's next maybe? So of course now we have to deepen your knowledge somehow to make you get used to all the syntactic nightmares of C++ and also through all the difficulties, and yeah, such that you get just more experience and yeah, feel better with C++. There will also be a summer exercise sheet. If I recall correctly, it's probably the next exercise sheet, which will give you the chance to, in addition to the ordinary or usual 16 points, you can get some additional 16 points, which count on top of your point account, so to say. So you can make up for some exercise sheets where you maybe not performed that well. Again, we will talk about object-oriented programming, which is very important. We will start discussing that in the next lecture, if I recall correctly. We will in the future also discuss about threads and how to use asynchronous tasks, so which essentially means how to run computations in parallel. I mean, most modern machines nowadays have multiple cores, and I guess at this point in time in 2020 you should be able to know how to use a programming language in such a way that you can also make use of all your multiple cores within your machine. That's just knowledge that you need to know at this point in time. We will also have one lecture about high performance computing and what you should know about it, so how to craft programs that run particularly efficient. That will be quite interesting, I guess. If we find the time, we will also have a small lecture on static analysis, which hopefully helps you to understand the compiler a bit better, and also the difference about compile time, static compile time, and dynamic runtime. So hopefully after the static analysis lecture, you will know that difference a bit better if you not already know it anyways. We have lots and lots of tasks in our research group to do, more than we can do on our own. So usually we also can offer you some jobs. So I will also give you some details about job offers in one of the next lectures. And then at last, we will have the introduction to the final project. So that means I will present the final project to you. I will explain to you what you need to do, what you need to solve, basically. And then at the very end, we will also have some hacks and miscellaneous, some fun stuff again, yeah, which might be interesting to you, to some of you at least. You can also watch a nice talk by Bjarne Straustrup that recaps everything that we discussed so far and probably also lots more. I referenced it on the current exercise sheet, which I already uploaded, and also you can use this link here. It's 1.5 hours, but it's quite interesting and a brief summary of what we did so far, I guess. Okay, that would be already it for today. So what did we discuss today? We talked about template metaprogramming. We talked about variadic template arguments, ownership and ownership problematic. Talked about smart pointers and how smart pointers can help you to cope with the ownership problematic. We discussed unit pointer, shared pointer, and weak pointer, and the current status quo. This is where we are right now. So thank you very much. That would be it for today. See you later on in the live stream for the exercises. And other than that, have a nice weekend. Bye bye.